Simon & Schuster Audio presents Star Trek Legacies Book 1, Captain to Captain, by Greg Cox. Based on Star Trek, created by Gene Roddenberry. Read by Robert Petkoff.
Historian's note. The events in this story take place during different missions of the Starship Enterprise. In 2245, the Enterprise was launched from the San Francisco yards under the command of Robert April. After a major refit was finished in 2264, command of the Starship passed to James Kirk. The events that occur during Kirk's mission take place several months after the Enterprise crew's journey to the diplomatic conference on Babel. Journey to Babel. 2267. 1. Captain's log, stardate 3950.1. The Enterprise is en route for some much-needed shore leave on Chippewa Prime. In the meantime, we find ourselves expecting a visit from a most distinguished guest whom Mr. Spock knows far better than I. Tractor beams guided the sleek courier ship into the Enterprise's spacious hangar deck. Half the size of a shuttlecraft, the Shimizu was small but fast, designed for emergency deliveries of medical supplies, key diplomatic personnel, or anything else that urgently needed to be someplace yesterday short of any actual time travel. Its aerodynamic contours enclosed the twin warp nacelles into a pair of triangular wings, the better to allow for planetary landings and atmospheric maneuvers. A white enamel glaze protected its streamlined hull. As Kirk understood it, the decommissioned Starfleet vessel was now more or less at the disposal of their newly arriving visitor, which testified to her illustrious career in Starfleet as well as to the high regard in which she was held.
"Right on schedule," Kirk observed. "I always heard that she was known for her punctuality."
"You heard correctly, Captain," Spock said. "In my experience, she is admirably precise in all matters." Along with Dr. McCoy, Kirk and Spock viewed the Shimizu's arrival from the observation deck overlooking the landing bay. The men were decked out in their best dress uniforms, complete with medals, decorations, and metallic gold piping. McCoy tugged on his uniform's stiff collar, no doubt wishing he was in his regular blue duty tunic instead.
"So tell me, Spock," the doctor asked, "are you looking forward to chewing the fat with your old crewmate?"
"As a Vulcan, I find that to be a singularly distasteful idiom, but if you must know, I am indeed pleased at the prospect of renewing our acquaintance." Spock appeared perfectly at ease in his formal attire, which suited his reserved manner and bearing. "She has an exceptional mind, and is much less inclined to indulge in gratuitous emotional displays than certain other Starfleet personnel I could name." McCoy huffed in mock indignation.
"Who are you calling gratuitous, you insufferable green-blooded—"
Now, gentlemen," Kirk interrupted, chuckling. "Company's calling, so let's be on our best behavior."
"All right," McCoy muttered, "but he started it."
"Excuse me, Captain."
Yeoman Lisa Bates joined them on the observation deck. She was a slim, athletic redhead whose coppery tresses were piled high in a stylish beehive. Having recently taken over as Kirk's personal yeoman after previously serving aboard the Constellation, she had so far proven herself organized and attentive to a fault. She held out a data slate and stylus.
"Do you have a moment to sign off on the latest requisitions from the galley?"
The Shimizu was still touching down on the hangar deck, so Kirk accepted the proffered items from Bates. A quick glance at the paperwork revealed nothing out of the ordinary, so he approved the requisitions and handed them back to Bates, who lingered on the deck, seemingly in no hurry to depart.
"Is there anything else, Yeoman?" Kirk asked.
"No, sir," she said a trifle sheepishly. "It's just that, well..."
Kirk thought he knew what this was about.
"Would you like to stay and meet our guest, Yeoman?"
Her youthful face lighted up.
"Yes, Captain, with your permission, of course. Her career and accomplishments have always been an inspiration to me.
As well they should be, Kirk said, amused. Nothing wrong with a little hero worship, he decided, particularly when directed at a worthy target. Very well, yeoman. Feel free to stick around.
Thank you, Captain. I appreciate it.
Down on the hangar deck, the Shimizu had come to rest, while the hangar's clamshell space doors were closing, sealing off the bay from the vacuum outside. This rendezvous was taking place in deep space, light years away from the nearest system. The Enterprise's own shuttlecraft were currently parked one level below in the maintenance hangar in order to accommodate the visiting courier. Kirk watched from above as the Shimizu powered down. He walked over to a comm unit on the wall and pressed the speaker button.
Kirk to bridge. The Shimizu is safely aboard. Resume course for Chippewa Prime, Warp 5.
The Enterprise had naturally dropped out of warp to receive the smaller spacecraft, but now they could get back up to a decent cruising speed. Honored guest or not, his crew were no doubt looking forward to their shore leave, which they had more than earned, especially after all that excitement on the way to the Babel conference several months back. Kirk's hand drifted toward his ribs, where that Orion assassin had stabbed him. His wound had healed nicely, but he still winced at the memory.
Aye, Cap'n, Lieutenant Commander Montgomery Scott replied from the bridge. We'll be back underway in two shakes of a lamb's tail, sir.
His robust Aberdeen accent came through the comm system loud and clear.
Will you be needing me to hold down the fort much longer? I shudder to think what mischief my engines might be getting up to in my absence.
Kirk smiled. He knew that, given a choice, Scotty would rather be toiling in engineering than occupying the captain's chair on the bridge.
Just a tad longer, Mr. Scott. We still have our renowned visitor to attend to.
He glanced down at the Shimizu one level below. The courier had yet to disgorge its passenger.
Kirk out.
Landing bay repressurized,
the ship's computer announced via a concealed speaker.
Access allowed.
That's our cue, Kirk announced.
He turned toward his companions.
Gentlemen, yeomen, let's not keep our guest waiting.
They descended by turbolift to the hangar deck, stepping out into the spacious bay even as the Shimizu's starboard hatch opened and a short set of steps extended onto the deck. The welcoming committee fell into position with Kirk in the forefront as their visitor emerged from the craft. She was a tall, handsome woman who looked to be in her mid-40s, with long black hair that as yet showed no sign of gray. Shrewd blue eyes surveyed her surroundings, while her cool demeanor was almost Vulcan in its inscrutability. Unlike Kirk and the others, she was dressed for comfort, not ceremony, and in contrast to the current trend in Starfleet uniforms, had opted for crisply pressed black trousers instead of a skirt. The captain's bars on the sleeve of her gold tunic testified to her rank. A simple black carryall hung from a strap over her shoulder.
Welcome aboard, Captain, Kirk greeted her. Or should I say, welcome back?
The former will suffice.
She glanced around the bay, perhaps comparing it with her memories. Her neutral tone offered little clue as to what was going through her mind.
But I appreciate the sentiment.
Her roaming gaze lighted on Spock.
Mr. Spock, now I do feel rather more at home.
A slight smile softened her expression.
Good to see that the Enterprise still has a highly capable first officer.
I can only succeed you, he replied, not surpass you.
The woman, once known as Number One, approached the others as the hatchway automatically closed behind her. Kirk understood that she was the only passenger, having piloted the Shimizu herself.
No need for flattery, Commander. We both know that I am hardly susceptible to such blandishments.
No flattery intended, Spock said. Your record, both on the Enterprise and subsequently, speaks for itself.
And quite eloquently, Kirk added. The captain was sincere in his praise. Although not well acquainted with their visitor, having previously only met her in passing at various high-level Starfleet conferences, he was quite familiar with her impressive history, which dated back to the very earliest voyages of the Starship Enterprise. After serving with distinction under both Captains Robert April and Christopher Pike, she had eventually been awarded command of her own ship, the USS Yorktown, which was currently undergoing a major refit after several years of deep space exploration. Starfleet's scuttlebutt was that she would be promoted to Commodore soon and perhaps reassigned to Starfleet Command in San Francisco. Kirk wondered how she felt about that possibility after having trod the decks of a starship for at least 2 decades. For himself, Kirk was in no hurry to be elevated to a desk job, not when there was still so much of the galaxy left to explore. "It seems I'm outnumbered," she said dryly, "so I suppose I have no choice but to accept your compliments in the spirit in which they are intended." "A highly logical conclusion," Kirk said. "No wonder you and Spock worked so well together." "He was an excellent science officer," she recalled, "despite his relative youth and inexperience at first." Spock raised an eyebrow.
"Both of which defects were significantly remedied during the time we served together."
"I should hope so," she replied. McCoy snickered in the background, clearly enjoying this.
"Hard to imagine Spock as a green young officer," the doctor said, interjecting himself into the conversation. "Well, aside from the..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.